May I say good morning to you all. A warm welcome to our service of Holy Communion. I always love it before the service, listening to everybody talking and catching up with each other. It's beautiful. So a warm welcome to you. I hope your week has been good. And once again, we can gather on a Sunday morning to worship our God, to hear his word and gather around his table. A couple of things just to say as introduction to the service. For those of you who were here a week ago, you may remember that I was, let's just say, perspiring greatly with all those robes on in that heat. So the church wardens have kindly said, don't worry about wearing robes when it's hot. And although it's a little bit cooler, I have gratefully said yes to that offer. So thank you. Thank you, church wardens. This is great. So I've got my suit on. I like my suit. Also, Kobe is away this week, but we're delighted that Shannon is playing for us once again. Thank you. Thank you so much. And everything else that you need to know will be in our service order. It will be announced. Well, you know the drill. We'll worship our God together. Let's just take a moment of quiet, shall we? To quieten our hearts, to remember that the Lord is here and he comes to work. Heavenly Father, we praise you for your love and your grace. We thank you for each other. We thank you for this time where we can come, connect with our family, praise you, and remember your love and your grace. Father, we would ask now that by your Holy Spirit, you will come and work, that you will come and work powerfully in each one of us. You know what we need this morning. Lift our hearts to you, we pray. Open our hearts wide to receive. And may we all leave here knowing that we've met with you, the living God. And we ask this, Father, in the name of him who died for us but is now alive and reigns at your right hand, forever one God, world without end. Amen. So we stand and we sing together our first hymn, The Kingdom of God is Justice and Joy.
Good morning. Please join with me in the words of the Collect for Purity. Almighty God,
unto whom all hearts be open,
all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts, the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Let us pray the collect for today. O God, who declarest thy almighty power,
most chiefly in showing mercy,
mercifully grant unto us such a of thy grace, that we, running the way of thy commandments, may obtain thy gracious promises, and be made partakers of thy heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please will you be seated for the first reading. The first lesson is written in the fourth chapter of Colossians, beginning at the second verse. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us the door for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer each person. Tychicus will tell you all about my activities. He is a beloved brother and faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. I have sent him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage your hearts. And with him, Onesimus, our faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. They will tell you of everything that has taken place here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, greets you. And Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, concerning whom you have received instructions, if he comes to you, welcome him. And Jesus, who is called Justus. These are the only men of the circumcision among my fellow workers for the kingdom of God, and they have been a comfort to me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you, always struggling on your behalf in his prayers, that you may stand mature and fully assured in all the will of God. For I bear him witness that he has worked hard for you and for those in Laodicea and Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, greets you, as does Demas. Give my greetings to the brothers in Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house. And when this letter has been read among you, have it also read in the church of the Laodiceans, and see that you also read the letter from Laodicea. And say to Archippus, see that you fulfill the ministry that you have received in the Lord. I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand. Remember my chains. Grace be with you. Here ends the lesson. We're now going to pray Psalm 81. Please join in the words which are in the even-numbered verses in the bold print. Sing aloud to God our strength. Shout for joy to the God of Jacob.
I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of
But my people didn't listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me. So I gave them to follow. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. I turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe toward him, and their fate would last forever. But instead of the wheat, and with honey from the rock, I would satisfy. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Please stand for the next hymn. Please remain standing for the gospel.
I'm going to read the gospel from the New Revised Standard. The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet. Do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place," and then, in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher." Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He also said to the one who had invited him, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers and sisters or relatives or rich neighbors, in case they might invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." The Gospel of Christ.
Father, we thank you for the gift that your word is to us. We now pray that your Holy Spirit will come. Open our hearts to understand, interpret, and then by your grace, grant to us the courage to live it. And we ask this to the glory of your name. Amen. Please be seated. So it's part 7 of our little series in this wonderful little letter. And we pick it up exactly where we left off, or not quite, because we slightly go back over ground we didn't quite have time to cover last week. We're going to pick it up from that passage, chapter 3, verses 18 to chapter 4, verse 1, where Paul describes how we're to live in the world, wise in the way we are to be around those who have different values to we do. We are to be the fragrance of the Lord Jesus, Paul tells us, to waft him wherever we go. It is to be wise, smart with those around us, a bit like Jesus described in the passage that Cynthia's just read to us, remembering that the context in this letter are those five marks of the healthy, happy, and authentic church that Paul describes. Now, I know that you've memorized them all by now, but for those of you who've forgotten, here they are. Here's what we've been looking at these last 7 weeks. Rooted and established in Christ, Jesus at the center of all we do. Secondly, growing in our knowledge and love of God, but that's not just for head knowledge's sake. It's so thirdly, we can model our lives as Jesus, living Jesus-shaped lives. Fourthly, living as a church family. We saw how Paul takes that language of family and not just community. And then finally, living with good news to share, that there's an outward element to our discipleship, taking that love of God as we engage with the mission of God. Applying these five marks to our corporate life is something you're going to be hearing a lot about as we go into the fall and 2023. And there are two very important announcements at the end of this service with that in mind. But on that cliffhanger, let's move on. I want to read verses 2 to 6 again, and then we'll pick it up from there. This is what Paul wrote. "Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us, that God may open a door to us for the word, to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech be always gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. So what she's saying? Well, just as we are mindful, intentional, and wise in the way that we waft Christ with all in our life, whoever we engage with, whoever you engage with in your own particular circumstances, family, friends, work colleagues, neighbors, whoever it might be, do so always watchful in prayer. And then Paul says, and please, in the middle of all of that, please don't forget to pray for us. And I want you to pray in this way, he says. Firstly, pray that God will open the door for us. Now, I don't know about you, but I find that liberating. It is God who opens the door, not us. It's not us who have to batter down the door of people's hearts so that they hear the good news of Jesus. Right at the start in our first sermon on this, we looked at those words, shoulds, as a reflective tool. What is it in our life that we feel we should be doing? And I kind of grew up in a church that made it very clear that no, we had to go battering down the door. And from that grows this kind of interesting kind of idea that we can, and I'm parodying now, go up to a complete stranger and say, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb, stranger? You know, that kind of thing. No. It's God who opens the door. And I just kind of wonder, just as I think back in my own life, what damage have I done to people's walk with God, where I've been a bit too impatient or didn't quite grasp that that was God's job and not mine? So that's the first thing he says, that God will open the door. And that's liberating. This is the Lord's work. And what is the purpose of the door being opened? So that the mystery of Christ might be proclaimed. Well, what is that? Well, we often assume it's an act of speaking. I've got to say something. Door's open, whoosh, la 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 la, whatever it might be. Yet, when we take a step back and take a broader look, for example, at Jesus and the Gospels, we can see that that's not just always words. Here's John 31, verses 34 to 35. A new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you are also to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So let's get this right. So what Jesus is saying, by our love for each other, we show that we are the Lord's disciples. People who aren't his see that we are his when they observe our love for each other. So when do they see that happening? If they're not here on a Sunday morning, where do they see that happening? If we don't feel we can invite our friends to a Sunday morning, how do we systemically arrange it so that we can do things together that we could invite our friends to, who then can see, wow, look at the way these guys love each other. What is it that drives that? We need to have that systemically in place. And there's another announcement about that at the end of the service. More of that very soon. And see, and once it's open, Paul's request that then Paul would be able to respond correctly. Now, I kind of feel, and it was interesting, at the 8 o'clock, there was a kind of slight groan of disapproval about this, so we had a little chat afterwards. I think it's a way a bit easier for Paul to proclaim the mystery of Christ in his day than it is for us now. Let me explain. In those days, everybody didn't just believe in God. They believed in deities. Everybody believed in God. There were so many different kind of gods that you invested your commitment to the one that you thought was most powerful. And because you maybe have got it wrong and you didn't want to lay anybody out and offend actually the God that was more powerful that you didn't quite know about, you worshipped everyone. And so you can see all these history shows where they got all the little statues of all the different gods in their house because they didn't want to upset any of the gods. So in those days, the Christian witnesses, we believe in one God, was so radical as to be unbelievable. We kind of like lost that a bit, isn't it? When we say the creed, that was radical for the time it was written. So Paul does not have to do what we do, which is to argue that there's a God at all. We've got to start in a much different place than Paul did. So where do we start? How do we proclaim the truth about God? Well, I guess it's important to know where we start. And for those of you who were born, let me think, 1965 or earlier, which I guess is some of us, the world has changed since we first learned how to do this. In 1975, a book came out called What's Wrong with the Harvest by a guy called Max Engel. He was a Danish theologian, and he came up with a thing called the Engel scale. This is what a person goes through to be someone who's anti anything to do with God, to being an active disciple and leader in the church. And he came up with 40 steps. Here are the condensed 6 steps of the Engel scales. Over here, not interested. Absolutely not interested in anything to do with your faith. Thank you very much. I'm sure we've all got people in our lives like that. Next step, growing awareness. Is there a God? What happens when I die? Those big questions of life start to be asked. Next step, seeking answers to those questions within a church family, seeking what Christians believe about those big questions. Next step, gathering the basic facts of the faith. So Christians believe, okay, Jesus was the Son of God, he died for me somehow, rose again, sent the Holy Spirit, okay. Next step, decision. What am I going to do in the light of the facts I have learnt? Before then, if it's a yes, discipleship and growth. That was 1975. It's not like that anymore. The world has changed. And in a version that's an update of the Engel scale, Doug Shapps, in his fantastic book, I Once Was Lost, asked a lot of postmodern young people, how did they come to faith? We've still got a number of steps, but now they're very different. Firstly, absolutely not interested in your faith. Thank you very much. So that step is just the same. What moves them? Simply this. They have a trustworthy friend who happens to be a Christian. A trustworthy friend who happens to be a Christian. Or, put it another way, a trustworthy Christian. So what do we do to help that step from that to that? Invest in our friendships. Get to know people. Just be around people. Prove ourselves trustworthy. This is how F.F. Bruce put it in his wonderful commentary on the book of Colossians. Many who are not Christians may not read the Bible or listen to the preaching of the Word of God, but they can see the lives of those who do and form their judgment accordingly. So, first step in today's culture, prove ourselves a trustworthy friend. The next step is that our friend, bearing in mind this is friends, become curious and then has some questions about faith that is not yet personal for them. So what's all that about then? Well, you know, what do you believe about this, that and t'other? How do we help them with that step? Well, simply talk. When asked, answer their questions. Discuss with them their view of God or our view of God, but because this is with friends, It's in a non-defensive and a non-argumentative manner. We don't have to persuade them. Remember, it's God who opens the door, not us who has to batter it down. The next step is that our friend becomes open. Maybe they've seen us loving each other. Maybe they've come to something we've arranged and say, do you know, that lot have got something. My friend's got something and they've got it too. What is it? They've become open. They become more aware that perhaps their emotional or spiritual needs, which they have never to been considered could be met by God, could actually be met by this God that my friend follows. And how do we help with that? Well, we just chat with them about personal growth, growing as people, how they want to grow personally and how God might help them with that, how God has helped us with that. The phrase, I have found, is a wonderful phrase we could use because it's just our experience. This is what I've found. What we could do, maybe they would like us to pray with them. We can offer that. But of course, we're praying for them all the time anyway. The next step is that our friend has become someone actively exploring Jesus now, but does not know how to seek Jesus for answers. And how do we help with that? Well, focus their steps. Questions like, if you can ask Jesus one honest question that would help you trust him, what would you ask him? Bearing in mind all the time, this is a friend. We're just sharing our lives and our thoughts. And then the next step, our friend has been exploring Jesus and now may be ready to follow him. How do we help them? Well, maybe it's then, right then, only at the end, might we need to explain the gospel to them. So instead of first, it's now last. And it starts with being a trustworthy friend. I love that picture. And I found that to be true over the last 6-7 years after I've been introduced to that model. And all of that, understanding this bit, and then this bit, and then this bit, and then this bit, and then this bit, being friends to start off with, is a perfect illustration for me of what Paul says in verse 5. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders. Make the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you know how to answer each person. Well-seasoned words are what Paul is saying are called for. Seasoned with salt was a very familiar idiom in the first century, and scholars believe that in ordinary Greek, it simply meant sparkling conversation, witty banter, chat, that kind of thing. One of the church fathers called Plutarch wrote this, for wit is probably the tastiest condiment of all. Therefore, some call it graciousness because it makes the necessary chore of eating pleasant. Fantastic. So how's the small talk? How good are we as simply just being able to talk with people? You see, we can so often get down the track as I must learn how to explain the gospel. And we can't do the small stuff. How's the small talk? I love this because it says to me it might be appropriate to share Monty Python and the Knights with me at some times in just simply proving a trustworthy friend. It's who we are as people, who you are as a person, who you are with all your passions, hobbies, desires that speaks. That's where we start. So not only are each one of us dearly loved and uniquely created, God uses you as you are, with all that you like, to be the means by which you connect with other people and start with being a trustworthy friend. It's about being kind, gracious people who are interested in the lives of those around us. It's about a love for each other that is so deep we outlove the community leagues. I was going past the community league sign the other day, and it says, we seek to be loving, kind, and open to all. couldn't put it better myself. We got to be better than that, because we seek people to come to know Jesus. It's to be aware of the importance of our purpose as a church family, so we don't just stop at Jesus at the center and growing in our knowledge of God, but these other things as well. And I want to kind of give N.T. Wright the last word. I kind of shared last week, I've started reading The Day the Revolution Began. Oh, it's fantastic. And this week, I came across this quote. And he's talking about how we can so often get kind of focused on, we've got to get this right and this right and this right and this right, and know enough before God can use us that we actually miss the point. This is what he says. Jesus died for our sins, not so that we could sort out abstract ideas, but so that we, having been put right, could become part of God's plan to put his whole world right. That is how the revolution works. I love that. That's just fantastic. So in going forward, it gives us a model. Paul gives us a way of being together and in our own lives that it reflects us, that it reflects you, and starts simply with being a trustworthy friend that can share you with those in your life. And wouldn't it be great if we could in the future regularly include a slot where we welcome people into St. John's who are now new followers of Jesus? Wouldn't that be fantastic? Because we've simply got to know people and prayed for them and seen those steps take place. And that's not just for our sake. In fact, it's not for our sake at all. For if that happening, it means the kingdom of God is expanding to the praise and worship of our Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. So that is the purpose Paul gives the church in this letter. It is our hope, and by the grace of God, may it be our future. Let us pray. I invite you to lift to our God your friends, your family, the people you work with, the people you share hobbies with, your neighbors. We lift them to the Lord. And we pray for our interactions with them, that in every way we will waft the Lord Jesus, that we would be faithful friends, that we will allow Jesus to open the door, trusting that he'll speak in the way that he knows is best. Father, we lift before you all those that we've named in the quietness of our hearts. Work in us, we pray, that they discover how much they're loved by you, that they're drawn to your redeeming grace, that they enter your heavenly kingdom, that they become for you powerful agents of you, the living God, by which your name is praised and your kingdom continues to expand. Father, we ask this not for our sake, but for your glory, for we rejoice that you have found us, and we pray that you will find more and more of those in our lives and our city. And we ask this, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please would you stand and join in the words of the Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and was crucified, also for us unto Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again in glory, both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who spake by the prophets. One holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please would you sit, kneel, or find some other comfortable position to pray. Let us pray for Christ's Holy Catholic Church. Let us pray for peace on earth and for the unity of all Christian people. Let us pray for our mission at home and abroad. Let us remember before God those of our brethren who have departed this life and are at rest. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church militant here on earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to lead all nations in the way of righteousness, and so to guide and direct thy governors and rulers, that thy people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. And grant unto thy servant Elizabeth our Queen, and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. We pray for our world and our concerns for it. We lift to our God the situation in Ukraine. We lift to God the divisions we have seen in our own country and around the world. Almighty God and merciful Father, who wouldest have the kingdoms of the world become the kingdom of thy Son, Jesus Christ, bestow thy blessing, we beseech thee, upon all who labor for peace and righteousness among the peoples, especially for the people of Ukraine, that the day may be hastened when war shall be no more, and thy will only shall govern the nations upon earth, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. We pray for the Church. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, especially to thy servant Stephen, our bishop, that they may both by thy life and doctrine set forth thy true and living word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. In our prayer cycle for the worldwide Anglican Church, this week we pray for the Diocese of Minna in the Church of Nigeria. In the Diocese of Buye, we pray for the parish of Kabata. In our prayer cycle for the Diocese of Edmonton, we pray for the church family of Emmanuel Wetaskiwin. We pray that God will bless them in their life together in the praise to the praise of his name and the furtherance of his kingdom. We also pray for the Kihiwin Cree Nation, and we acknowledge that we are worshiping on the traditional lands of Treaty 6. Prosper, we pray thee, all those who proclaim the gospel of thy kingdom. We pray today for the ministry of Melissa and Alan Chettle as they work with university students through InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. We pray for Melissa as she works with the international students at the University of Alberta and the undergraduate students at Red Deer Polytechnic. We also pray for Alan and his work with graduate students and faculty at the University of Alberta, as well as his work with Christian medical and dental students at the U of A. We give thanks for the gifts God has given us and those who serve us. This week, we continue to pray for all the teachers and school workers who are members of our church family, along with all our children, youth, and their families, as they prepare to return to school. We give thanks to God for them and pray that God will protect, uphold, and sustain them. We also pray for all the preparations underway for the resumption of children's and youth ministry. We now lift before you, O Lord, all those for whom our prayers are desired, that you might bring forth your healing and wholeness. We pray especially for Carol, Mike, Marty, Edith, Witt, Melaine, Sadie and family, Brett, Connie, Ryan, Christina, Lindsay, Sue, Sydney, Donna, and Clarence, Paddy and family, Ainsley, Carly, Gertrude, Charity, Sheila, Jill, Hodan, Cara, Thomas, Will, Bob, Patricia, Rita, Jolene, Peter, Aggie, Michelle, Ida, Trish, Callista, Douglas, Patrick and Kyla, Rhea, Rick, Hilary, Joyce, Judy, Marianne, Vivian, Harold, and Daniel. We remember before thee, O Lord, all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, and we bless thy holy name for all who in life and death have glorified thee, beseeching thee to give us grace that rejoicing in their fellowship, we may follow their good examples and with them be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, for our only mediator and advocate, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
We continue in prayer as we pray for ourselves now, as we come to God in a prayer of confession. For ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw near with faith, and let us take this holy sacrament to our comfort, as together we make our humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon our knees. We pray together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all, we acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with heartfelt repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our next hymn speaks of us loving each other, of being a support and a help to each other. We stand and sing, Sister, Let Me Be Your Servant. Blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, for ever and ever. All that is in heaven and in the earth is thine. All things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. I invite you to sit, to stand, to kneel, whichever is most prayerful for you. As we prepare to gather together around the Lord's table, we begin with these wonderful sentences of Scripture. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that labour and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying and worthy of all to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If anyone sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty, everlasting God, creator and preserver of all things. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and singing. Blessing and glory and thanksgiving be unto thee, almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memorial of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, we thy humble servants with all thy holy church, remembering the precious death of thy beloved Son, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again in glory, do make before thee in this sacrament of the holy bread of eternal life and cup of everlasting salvation the memorial which he hath commanded. And we entirely desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And we pray that by the power of thy Holy Spirit, all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness and manifold and great mercies, worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. Where's the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our bodies may be made clean, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Of God. we gather around the Lord's table together. And just a reminder, particularly if you're here having not been here since we started to receive the common cup again, feel free to come forward and receive. If you're not ready to take the common cup yet, come anyway, but just hold the base. And then we can share the words of reception with you, because it is by faith we receive all that Jesus won for us on the cross. The table is set. Let us gather. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee that thou dost graciously feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, assuring us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are living members of his mystical body, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And here we offer unto thee, O Lord. Would you stand, please? Now we commend ourselves into the Lord's hands in the words of the blessing. So may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you and all those you love, wherever they may be, now and always. Amen. Before our final hymn, if I can ask you just to be seated for a moment, because as you gathered from the sermon, there are some very important announcements to share. And first up is Jane. Woohoo!
Good morning, St. John's. It's been a while since I've been standing up here in front of you. As some of you have known, I've been part of St. John's when St. John's was located at the University Avenue location. We won't talk about how many years ago that was. Some of my favorite memories growing up here are surrounded around my church family. whether that be Halloween parties in the church basement as a little girl, or decorating Christmas tree ornaments, putting on Italian night dinners and dances as a youth member, potlucks, church picnics, progressive dinners, and even more recently, our church New Year's Eve events that we held here at St. John's. Events that we invited many family and friends to. This is just to name a few. Events that we just got to be in fellowship with one another, and friends and family that we brought along with us, and we just had fun. So I'm standing before you today to let you know that we're starting up the Ministry of Fun. We will, throughout the year, have a variety of events for the purpose of fellowship and fun. These events will be open to you and your family and friends. The first of these events will be held on Saturday, September 17th at 7 o'clock downstairs in the Great Hall. We will be watching the family-friendly movie, great for all ages, Disney Pixar Up. Now, for you adults who think that Disney is just for kids, oh, you are missing out. This is a great way to kick off this ministry of fun and to get it going in an upward direction. So please come, please feel free to invite friends and family. There'll be more information coming next week and in the grapevine next week as well. Thank you so much.
Hello everyone. So I'm Melissa Chettle. I actually, first of all, wanted to just thank you for all of the ways that you pray for Alan and my ministry among students at the university. It's without your prayers, it's not possible to do ministry. And so we were prayed for today in the prayers, and I just felt like, yeah, I just want to thank you for that. And share with you an opportunity to continue to pray, but also if you want to love on international students, there's an opportunity to do that in a couple of weeks. We're hosting the international, not Christmas camp, World Welcome Party that we do every year. We haven't been able to do it the last couple of years, but this year we get to host it here at St. John's. And we're inviting all of you to come and love on international students. So we would love if you are excited at the idea of helping set up and welcome them and serve them the wonderful feast that we're going to feed them and help us take down. That would be a really good gift. If you really love to cook, we're doing it kind of potluck style, but we're not making any of the students cook. We're asking other people to bring a dish for 10 to 12 people that we can serve the international students and welcome them really well to Canada. So if you want to do any of those things, please come and talk to me, because then we know how many dishes we have and what dishes. If you are making a dish, keep in mind to avoid pork, because we have lots of students from other faiths that avoid pork, and so it's a super helpful thing that we can say, hey, you can have all of this food. It's a really loving, welcoming thing. So thank you so much for your prayers, and please come talk to me at coffee hour if you're excited about welcoming international students. Oh yeah, September 9th is the date. Sorry, thank you, Ranine. September 9th, and it'll be from 6:30 to 9 p.m., but we'll be setting up before and after, taking down.
Good morning, my name is Evelyn, and God has very recently connected me with an absolutely delightfully blessed and blessed family from Iran, from Afghanistan. A mom and a dad and three lovely young children. And I'm assisting them with furnishing their small apartment that is located very close to Meadowlark. If any of you or anyone that you might know would have a set of bunk beds that they might be willing to move from their home, I would be very delighted to be able to accept them for that family. Thank you.
Good morning. My name's Shannon, and on behalf of Kobe, who is away this weekend, I'd like to draw your attention to the invitation in the grapevine to join the St. John's choir groups starting on Thursday, September 8th at 7:30 for the senior choir, and Sunday, September 11th at 8:45 a.m. for the youth choir. And volunteer singers for the Lessons and Carols service in December. Rehearsals will begin in October. So if you love singing, and you're really good singers, by the way. I kind of followed you all morning. come and join. And yeah, thank you.
For those of you who don't know Shannon, which is probably most of you, Shannon's got the most amazing soprano voice, so well worth joining the choir just to hear her sing. So I just wanted to tell you a little story. I'm a member of a Facebook group called Edmonton Hosts Ukrainians, and the Thursday before last, the administrator contacted me and said, my family be willing to host a single mum and her 17-year-old son, who were arriving on Tuesday because they had nowhere else to live. So we had me message backwards and forwards a little bit, and I sent them a photograph of my 3-month-old chocolate Labrador puppy. So I went out to the airport to meet them, and I didn't know what they looked like, and they didn't know what I looked like. The only connecting link was the puppy. So anyway, they showed up, and they've been with us since Tuesday morning. And it's been a really joyful experience. She's just the most amazing cook. So we really, really enjoy having them. She said yesterday afternoon that Friday night was the first time she's had a happy dream. Happy dream. So, I mean, they lived in a place called Irpin, which is just outside Kyiv. It's one of the places which was trashed by the Russian army. And a bomb went off 500 meters from their apartment block, blew out all the windows. So they left in February. Went to stay with some friends in Ukraine, then went to Poland for 2 weeks, went to Ireland for 5 months, and now they're here. And so this is the first time that they've had a home for 6 months. So if you have it in your heart to host a Ukrainian family or some Ukrainians, even for a short period of time, it's a joyful experience, and I heartily recommend it to you. Thank you.
Final announcements. I think it's a sign the pandemic's drawing to an end. This is the most announcement and the longest they've taken so far. Isn't that exciting? Just to let you know that next week, at that period when the children and families and teachers return to school and all that there is therein, we're going to have the backpack blessing. So that will be the center of our service next week. Whenever anybody says to me, the children are the future of the church, I want to say, no, they're not. They are the church now. They're part of the family. So we're going to gather around them and honor them and pray and almost like commission them, God's protection over them as they go back into goodness knows what COVID will bring. So that's next Sunday, 10 o'clock. And finally, Janice, did you want to mention about the 18th or shall I do it? Okay. We've dotted the I's and we've crossed the T's. We can now announce that just as we began the summer with our service at Harolick Park on June the 25th. So we're gonna end it and go into the fall with another gathering, not here but outside, a time of fun and fellowship, and we pray good weather. But instead of Harolick Park, it's this time gonna be at the Lendrum Community Center and the grounds around it, hopefully. Maybe the baseball diamond, who knows? Whatever it might be. So that's September the 18th. More details in next week's Grapevine. Wonderful. Thank you, Toby. Thank you, Shannon. Flawless. perfect, brilliant, and coffee is served after, and we're having it out there? Conference room. Coffee in the conference room. Marvellous. And if you want to go outside, you can. Stay in the conference room, you can. But coffee is served if you've got time to talk. Wonderful. Our final hymn speaks, and it's got a beautiful picture. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee. This picture of the love of God transforming us. We stand and sing, joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Thank you for your company. Let us now depart in peace to love, waft, befriend, and serve. In the name of the Lord. Amen.